Ooh, hello, hi. I'm Little Richard, and welcome to the Weekend Rock. Flower children turn out in droves for a movie on the Doors. We'll have priceless footage of the Rolling Stones from a brand new home video. And there's a whole lot of shaking going on as heavy hitters from music and baseball square off in a game of charity softball. I'm John Norris, sitting in for Kurt Loder. This is The Week in Rock. The AIDS epidemic has claimed the life of another major talent, this time from the world of art. Keith Haring, the best-known and best-loved pop artist of the 1980s, died in his sleep early Friday morning at his home in New York of AIDS-related complications. The 31-year-old Haring left an indelible mark on the art world with his instantly recognizable graffiti-inspired works, of which the best-known were The Radiant Baby, The Barking Dog, which sometimes took on a half-human form, and A Zapping Spacecraft. Originally trained in Pittsburgh, the birthplace of another pop art giant, Andy Warhol, Haring moved to New York City in 1978, enrolled in the School of Visual Arts, and introduced his clever expressionist graphic designs to the subways and walls of the city. That street art soon found a following among Manhattan's downtown dealers, and prices for Haring canvases shot to tens of thousands of dollars. Last year, an ambulance chaser mentality sent those prices into the six-figure range after Haring publicly admitted he had the AIDS virus in an interview with Rolling Stone magazine. He had been taking the AIDS treatment drug AZT, and according to a spokeswoman, he had been holding his own against the disease until a couple of weeks ago when he was struck by laryngitis and flu-like symptoms. Last fall, MTV News interviewed Keith for our Decades special, and he bravely talked about how learning to live with AIDS had changed the way he looked at death and dying.
The thing that surprised me a lot is that you find ways to adapt to it somehow. I mean, I never thought that I would be able to deal with death or even be able to think about death in the way that I do now, because I've seen it a whole different way. I mean, after having the experience of really watching death, and especially because unfortunately AIDS is very, the disease itself is can be very painful and very very ugly disease. I mean, it's not pretty, it's not painless, and it's not quick, and so there's a lot of sort of suffering that goes with the thing, and there's a lot of sort of pain that you've got to sort of deal with, psychological and physical pain.
Haring won many friends and admirers in the music world, and among the performers he'd created works for were Duran Duran and Grace Jones. Even more significantly, he often used his work for positive social statements, including a well-known anti-apartheid poster, the cover of the 1988 album A Very Special Christmas to benefit the Special Olympics, and a safe sex campaign to combat AIDS. Ironically, tomorrow night at the Charles Lucian Gallery in New York, Haring's latest show was to open, two series of silk screen works inspired by the works of author William Burroughs. Our dealer, George Mulder, who's behind the exhibit, says the show will go on and run for a month at the gallery as planned, but he did say the opening would be low-key. On a much happier note, it was a big week in Hollywood this week when the nominations for the 62nd Annual Academy Awards were announced early Wednesday morning. Welcome back to The Week in Rock. In the past few weeks, our reporter Tim Summer has told you about some interesting and varied bands emerging from the underground rock talent pool of North Carolina. There was the roots rock of the Flat Duo Jets and the hard rock of Snatches of Pink, and this week, a unique foursome known as the Velt. They're a racially mixed outfit whose members' looks are sometimes confused with Terrence Trent D'Arby or Milli Vanilli, but whose sound has won them fans including Vernon Reid of Living Color and Robin Guthrie of England's Cocteau Twins. If you think that's strange, that's only the beginning. Here's more.
One of the most promising bands on the active North Carolina scene. After all,
few interracial groups are strongly influenced by the high drama, very white British pop of The Cure, New Order, The Cocteau Twins, and Echo and the Bunnymen.
Everybody thinks black people are being just like Living Color, 27 Spies. All those are great bands, but we're just afraid of being pigeonholed. Some little kid comes up and goes, "Can I have your autograph?" And I go, "Yeah, you know who we are?" He says, "Yeah, Living Color."
He thought he was Living Color and he was Milli Vanilli sitting together in the same plane.
So you, like, that's the biggest kind of mess now. Like, "Oh, you're Milli Vanilli, right?"
He actually thought he was Corey Terrence Trent Milli Vanilli Darber.
However, the band's most significant recent influence may be Robin Guthrie of the Cocteau Twins. Guthrie produced the band's forthcoming major label EP.
Multiracial band like here from North Carolina to know anything about the Cocteau Twins.
Yeah, they don't expect that, you know. They say, "Well, you know about them, you know?"
Yeah,
you know, why not?
Yeah, why not? Don't you know about James Brown?
The planes are driving. Things about this curious band, outsiders may find the strangest aspect of the belt to be the names of the twin brothers who lead the group, Daniel and Danny Chavis.
His is spelled D-A-N-I-E-L.
He's
spelled D-A-N-N-Y.
Yeah.
Danny.
I mean,
another interesting point is his name is Hugh Boyle and my name is Hugh Downs. So
there's really only two people in the band.
And the Velt will have an EP out on a major label sometime in the spring. Well, we couldn't let Valentine's Week go by without something having to do with relationships. So we took a look at a new book that dishes out advice on sexual relationships from a woman who knows something about the subject, Sydney Biddle Barrows. New York's Mayflower Madam, who ran a high-class escort service in Manhattan from 1979 to 1984, has now put together a book on sexual do's and don'ts. Mayflower Manners, Etiquette for Consenting Adults, is more than 200 pages on everything from bachelor pads to dating to the big SEX. But what about the premise of the book? A how-to on something you might think should come naturally. We took to the streets to find out what New Yorkers think of it.
I think the book is very useful because it doesn't address the larger questions like should you or shouldn't you do something, but rather the smaller questions which people either don't know how to phrase or don't have the guts to ask.
Like what, you ask? Well, like philosophies of flirtation, thoughts on where to hide condoms, suggestions for when and when not to rip the clothes off your lover, and plenty of stuff on all manners of sex.
I don't think I really want to know the etiquette of a lot of the stuff she discussed.
There are people who will read this and they think, you know, they will actually learn something from it, as opposed to like just... But she knows what she's talking about, especially the submission and dominance part, the basic etiquette tips.
This book is stupid. You should do whatever you want. You need a book. Who needs a book? If you need a book, then you shouldn't do it.
I like this line. "Touch me there now with your foot or I'll kill you." That's good.
I think that maybe Tipper Gore should start, like, worrying about this.
The chapter on the bachelor pad is very applicable because my boyfriend's refrigerator is completely empty. He had no toilet paper until my fourth visit. He ran out of toothpaste, and basically the place was a pigsty until I told him that I wasn't going to come over again until he provided the necessities.
Yes, the bachelor pad. According to the author's survey, most well-meaning guys assume they must provide relatively clean sheets and towels, some snacks, and of course condoms for the girlfriend staying overnight. But the women surveyed said they wanted more. Much more. If you want juicier details, and they're definitely there, you'll have to read the book. But the core of good sexual etiquette, according to the experts, is no secret.
It's best to err on the side of being polite and being considerate of another person. I think that's a very valid message.
Don't forget that shower cap, very important. And that'll do it for this edition of The Week in Rock. Be sure to join us for Monday's News at Night when Kurt will be in Los Angeles getting set for Wednesday's Grammy Awards. He'll go behind the scenes for a look at Grammy rehearsals and have a conversation with Cher. That's the News at Night, Monday at 11:30 p.m. Eastern, 10:30 Central. I'm John Norris. We'll see you then.